Hello, everybody, and welcome. It's lovely to see so many of you here. Welcome to this, which is the opening session of the Edinburgh World Writers Conference 2012. My name is Susie Nicklin, and I'm the Director of Literature at the British Council, based in London. And this is Nick Barley. He's the Director of the Edinburgh International Book Festival here in Edinburgh. And together, we've been working on this project. We've been to present a historic gathering of writers from all over the world. We heard a fantastic story this morning of two of the organizers having such an argument during a planning session 50 years ago that one of them hit the other over the head with a wine bottle and knocked them out, but we haven't done that yet. So I'm going to hand you over to Nick. Thanks.
Thank you, Susie. This conference takes place here in Edinburgh, which of course is a city that's famous all over the world for its literary achievements of the past, from Robert Louis Stevenson to Walter Scott, and right through to the present day, to the superstar authors of the 21st century whose voices reach around the world. And of course, that's the reason the city has been designated the world's first UNESCO City of Literature, something we're all very proud of here. Over the past 50 years, Scotland's literary culture has enjoyed a particularly vibrant period, with writers like Muriel Spark, Jim Kelman, among others, providing inspiration to many of the authors who are here today. That 50-year purple patch for Scottish writing has, without any doubt, been partly because of the Edinburgh Writers' Conference that took place here in Edinburgh in 1962. And that conference was organised by John Calder, with the help of Jim Haynes. Their contribution to this city has been absolutely immense. I'm delighted to say that John Calder is with us here today, and that Jim Haynes, when he's back from his doctor's appointment, will join us into the theatre. And so that I hope that just for now, you will join me in giving John, and then when he arrives, Jim, a big round of applause for the work they've done for this city. Thank you, John. And in co-organising this conference, the British Council and the Book Festival are indebted to the work of two academics at Strathclyde University, Angela Barty and Eleanor Bell, who've advised us along the way and who even gave us the spark of inspiration for hosting another conference 50 years after the first. And we're grateful to the organisations who've been so generous in supporting this conference. It really matters to us that we have so much support from the Scottish Government and its Festivals Expo Fund. It's an enlightened project from this government. Creative Scotland, Event Scotland, and the City of Edinburgh Council, and of course also the British Council. Thank you to your organisation, Susie.
Culture more generally has become one of Scotland's most important and influential exports. This year, the Scottish Government has recognised its importance by announcing that 2012 is the year of Creative Scotland. So we're delighted and honoured to be joined today by the Cabinet Secretary for Culture and External Affairs in the Scottish Government to provide the opening address for the 2012 World Writers' Conference. So would you please give a very warm welcome to Fiona Hislop. Thank you.
Good afternoon. I'm delighted to be here to open the Edinburgh World Writers' Conference, taking place as part of the 2012 Edinburgh International Book Festival, and a warm welcome to all of you who are visiting Scotland. This conference features a unique series of events over five jam-packed days, bringing together writers from around the world to explore, to share, and to debate the role of literature in today's society. Of course, as we've heard, Edinburgh first hosted a writers' conference 50 years ago. And so successful and influential was this event, it helped to bring about the explosion of literary festivals that we know today. A major programming partnership between the Edinburgh International Book Festival and the British Council has enabled this event to return here once again and celebrate this landmark time. And authors have been invited from across the globe to visit and revisit the themes first debated all those years ago in 1962. This time, the World Conference will be a truly global affair, not only with representation in person by authors from Australia to Pakistan and Norway to South Korea, to name but a few. and it will also be simultaneously broadcast online around the world in collaboration with the book festival's partner festivals, bringing into play the technologies of today's digital world, a very exciting development. And I am proud that the Scottish Government continues to support this festival, providing funding through our Expo Fund, the Edinburgh Festival's Expo Fund. And this year, £160,000 was awarded to this project, helping bring it to fruition. And of course, those of you who know Edinburgh during festivals time, those of you who are here for the first time, Edinburgh is abuzz with activity and creativity. But it, of course, it's a place that, like that all year round in many regards, but even more so during this vibrant summer festival period. It's fitting that all these spectrum of rich and diverse events within all the festivals are taking place in a year where we're trying to promote internationally the role of Creative Scotland. So this is the Year of Scotland. We're spotlighting and highlighting the best of our cultural talents on an international stage. And also, we're having this conference in a city, Edinburgh, the UNESCO City of Literature, a wonderful accolade acknowledging this city and indeed our role as a centre for literature. So it's a busy year ahead for the World Writers' Conference. After here, moving across the globe to 15 other host countries, witnessing the passions of authors worldwide, building the most complete picture of writing and its relationship in our lives than ever before. And it will be a journey that I'll be keen to follow with interest. At the beginning of this week, we held the first ever International Culture Summit with delegates from 33 governments, with ministers debating in private space the role of politicians and the politics of culture. In a few moments, the first debate will kick off this conference, debating the theme, Should Literature Be Political? With a different topic each day for the four remaining debates, I'm sure it will generate amazing and different responses, a barrage of views, political, emotional, personal. But importantly, I hope you really engage and that you really fire each other with the intellect and the vision and the ideas I'm sure you have in this conference. Finally, I'd like to congratulate all those involved in organising the conference and the Edinburgh International Book Festival and the British Council in particular. But also, I want to really extend a warm Scottish welcome to all our participating authors, the audiences, and the host nations. I wish them well in the events that will follow this conference. I wish you well. I hope you have a very successful conference.
So, this year's conference draws its inspiration from the 1962 event in all sorts of ways. The British Council was established nearly 80 years ago, where the UK's leading agency for cultural relations. And I'm really pleased to say that 50 years ago, we were involved in bringing some of the writers to the conference here from overseas. Although obviously a large part of the work that we do is sending British writers overseas to events. The 2012 conference will differ slightly from 1962 because the discussion is going to continue beyond this theatre in a truly worldwide conversation that begins today. All of the sessions, including this one, are being filmed and broadcast across the world via the internet. We're expecting to receive comments from audience members and writers in other countries in response to the things that are being discussed in Edinburgh this weekend. And if we can, we'll be feeding some of them into the conference sessions if there's time. And then beyond this week's sessions, as the Minister has said, we will be doing more than 14 events all the way around the world to come places like Krasnoyarsk and Istanbul and Cape Town. And we'll be coming back here to Edinburgh next summer to bring the threads of the conversations all together again.
The conference is proud, excuse my voice, this conference is proud to welcome 50 writers, leading writers from all over the world, to join us today and take part in this discussion. And we hope that you, the writers, and the rest of you, the audience, will play a part in what we believe to be making a piece of history this week in this conference. On to today's session. The chair of today's session is one of Turkey's leading novelists. She's also a columnist, and on top of all that, she's trained as a political scientist. Her work has been translated into more than 30 languages, and she is the most widely read woman writer in Turkey. One measure of that popularity is her Twitter following, which is now something like 700,000. Her novel, The 40 Rules of Love, has sold over 500,000 copies, and The Bastard of Istanbul was longlisted for the Orange Prize. And her latest novel, Honor, has just been published. And she and AHDAF SOUEIF, our polemicist today, will be signing copies in the signing tent after this session. So please give a very warm welcome to Elif Shafak.
It's an immense pleasure for me to be here today and to chair such a special event, to be in the company of fellow writers, authors, and beautiful minds. In fact, last night I woke up at 3 o'clock with a panic attack, realizing there were going to be 300 people in this room, and this would not be an ordinary audience. These are people who are book lovers, story lovers. These are people of words and people with opinions, perhaps strong opinions. That means 300 different interpretations, 300 different expectations. So in the morning, as I was considering checking early flights back to Istanbul, my daughter gave me a call. She's 5.5 years old, and apparently she has figured out how to make international calls while I was away. So she asks me what I'm doing, and I told her the truth. I said, you know, I'm panicking. She was in a Christmas play last year, in a musical. It was a musical. So she listens, and she had to learn to overcome her stage fright. So she listens to me with that expertise, and she said, but don't worry. If you forget what you're going to say, you can mouth the lyrics. So I'm not going to mouth the lyrics, but I thought it was a good metaphor, actually, because I think this is a very unusual session. And what we are going to do today is some kind of music. And if we manage to do it well, if we manage to, you know, put our heads together, put our hearts together, I think this music could be revolutionary music. Today we will be discussing a question that sounds very simple and straightforward when we first hear it. Should literature be political? But at the same time, I think it's a very multi-layered question, and it's quite complicated. As we explore the intersection of literature and politics, we will also be talking or thinking about the value and perhaps the purpose of literature in today's changing world, East and West. Until recently, we used to believe, or perhaps the meta-narrative used to tell us, that some societies are static, that they were unable to change from within, that they didn't have that kind of dynamism. And after having witnessed the Arab Spring, after having seen that kind of unexpected transformation, you know, one country after another, I don't think there's anybody left who thinks that there are some static societies. No society is static. All societies are fluid. They're constantly changing, as we're speaking right now. So, on the one hand, it's quite inspiring, but on the other hand, it's a bit demoralizing, because what is going to be the role of literature? What's going to be the role of art in such a ever-shifting world? The World Writers' Conference is being presented by the Edinburgh International Book Festival and the British Council together, as we have seen. It's also supported by the Scottish Government, Creative Scotland, City of Edinburgh Council, and Event Scotland. But I think the impact of this conversation that we're going to have here is going to be much larger, and hopefully it will reach outside Scotland and it will travel east and west. In a way, the subject of today's discussion is going to be the centerpiece of this year's program. This is the first, as has been mentioned, this is the first of a series of events that will bring writers from different genres together, as well as from different backgrounds, cultures, different ethnicities, not to mention different standpoints. And I think this is not something that we experience very often. Actually, it's a very rare event. As writers, especially, if I may say, as novelists, I think we're very self-centered individuals. We live in our own bubbles. Oftentimes, we don't even know what, you know, the other one is saying. We don't even listen to each other. I'm not even sure we read each other's works much, you know. When we read a book, if it's not a good novel, we don't read that novelist anymore. And if it's a good novel, we don't read that novelist anymore. So we prefer that, we like that, and maybe we thrive upon that. But the downside of that is we don't have too many cross-genre or cross-cultural conversations. And in that sense, too, I think this is a very special occasion. Walter Benjamin used to call the art of writing the loneliest form of art. You know, writers are lonely when they're writing, and readers are lonely when they're reading a book. We thrive upon that solitude, but today's event is going to change that in the other direction. And I think there's no need for me to remind you that today's event is in a way honors what happened 50 years ago in 1962. It was a quite remarkable session, apparently. It was so influential, it was so powerful, and in some ways it was so provocative that I think it changed forever the way literary conferences were being organized afterwards. Of course, the speakers at that event were quite remarkable. There were people like Muriel Spark, like Rebecca West, like William Burroughs. And there were lots of heated debates, as has been mentioned. There were lots of passionate arguments. As a matter of fact, when the organizers told me before I came here that they were expecting us to perform no less remarkably than our ancestors, than our predecessors, I was slightly worried because there were some tensions apparently at the time as well, and some writers at the end of the session came to hate each other, almost, not quite, but almost came to blows, they're reported to say. But I think it's remarkable that today we are marking the anniversary of this wonderful conference half a century ago. Now, I should tell you a little bit about the format of the event, because it's a bit confusing. But I think it's very colorful at the same time, and it's quite egalitarian, if I may say. In a minute, I will be introducing our wonderful keynote speaker, and she will be speaking for about 15 or 20 minutes. After that, I will be asking her a few questions, but with those questions, we're going to move into a completely, fully open debate in which all the authors present here under this roof with me today will take part, hopefully, in this conversation. There are 50 participants here, all of them participants in the Writers' Conference this year. In addition to that, we have a small number of authors who are willing and ready to make mini speeches of perhaps about 4 minutes long. So they're also ready to do that. But not only authors, I would strongly welcome the audience to participate with your questions, with your comments and critical remarks. And when I say the audience, I don't only mean the people here in this room, but also the people who are following us online right now. And we will be receiving questions via email, Twitter and Facebook, and Anna, I believe, will be monitoring these questions for us, and every now and then she will add them in. So we will have all these streams, rivers of, you know, speeches, thoughts, ideas pouring in the same direction. At the end of the session, hopefully, we will have, you know, brought up so many colorful ideas, so many good points of emphasis, we might get a little bit lost. So to prevent that danger, to prevent that from happening, Owen Shears will very kindly come here on stage, and he will make a summary, because we're going to need that wise voice and analytical mind to pull together all the points that have been made in the session. And every now and then, I will also make some quotes from writers, past and present. So there will also be the ghosts of writers who are not alive today, but their words are very much alive. So their ghosts will be also with us today in this tent. So as you can see, this is not a typical literary conference at all. It is not a typical keynote speech or a panel. I think we're going to have a most unusual, if not radical, event. And there will be multiple actors. Of course, there will be a wonderful keynote speaker, but there will be multiple actors. And definitely, the best thing is no hierarchies. There will be no distinction between the stage and the audience, listeners and speakers, and I think that's very precious. It will be an orchestra of voices with different tones, of course, but perhaps a common concern for two things: the well-being of our common humanity and the well-being of books. And I think these two things are very much interrelated. Therefore, please do not hesitate. When you want to agree or disagree, challenge, just join in. And finally, I have to make one more point. I have to let you know that everything will be recorded and it will be broadcast online, recorded for the future as well. Therefore, members of the audience, when you want to speak, please wait until somebody brings you a microphone so that we can record it properly. And members of the Writers' Conference, before you speak, can I ask you to introduce yourself, say a few things about yourself. Perhaps the people here under this roof don't need that, but our global audience might greatly benefit from that. I think that would be very nice. Now, I would like to introduce our keynote speaker. It is a great privilege for me to do that. As a matter of fact, I don't think she needs much introduction. She's very well known for her fiction as well as for her non-fiction across countries. AHDAF SOUEIF is, in my opinion, one of the most important literary voices in this age who are trying to bridge cultural gaps and geographical distances. She is the author of short story collections like Aisha and The Sandpiper. She's the author of novels like In the Eye of the Sun and my favorite, The Map of Love, which was shortlisted for the Man Booker Prize. And her latest work is called Cairo, My City, Our Revolution. And I believe she will be referring particularly to this book, and we will be talking about it. But not only her fiction, her non-fiction also is very important for us. She's a political commentator. She writes essays on a wide range of issues, extending from fragments from cultural life to political transformation. And her essays have been published in a variety of international publications like The Guardian, Granta, or El País, or Le Monde, or the Arabic publication Al Hayat. But in my opinion, in addition to her fiction and nonfiction, it is her genuine voice, her sincere insight into the lives of real, so-called ordinary people in the Arab world that is also very, very precious for us. You know, men and women on the streets, in their homes, what they're feeling, what they're going through. These are the things that we don't hear much about, and AHDAF's voice helps us to hear their stories. And today, I believe she will be answering the question, our main question, should literature be political? I believe she will be answering it in the affirmative, and then we will take it from there. I'm very much looking forward to hearing her thoughts, as I believe you are. So please do join me in welcoming her. And we're a bit looking forward to listening to you.
Hello, everybody, and good afternoon. First, I'd like to thank the British Council, of course, the Edinburgh Festival, for inviting me and for making it possible for me to be part of this exciting and potentially really important and transformative event. Thank you. I'm looking forward very much to the discussion. My sense is that that we are going to have a very rich exchange, that minds that think that they're made up might not in fact be made up. And I'm looking forward very much to that. But to get to that, I have to do my bit first, which is to read this statement. I don't think it's going to take 20 minutes or even 15 minutes. My brief was to write 1,200 words, and so I think I'd have to read really slowly for it to take that long. So, I much, much prefer to speak rather than to read, but this had to be a prepared statement for various reasons. That's the format. And so I'm going to read it, and I will just tell you that, I'll tell you two things. One is that it also comes out in Arabic at the same time, so as it appears on the web here, the blog or the website here in this form, it also appears on the Al Shuruq, that's the paper I write a column for, in Arabic at the same time. I'll also tell you that this was very much brinkmanship. I mean, I took the commission months ago, And I knew I had to sort of, you know, deliver a kind of what I thought I was going to say, or a rough draft, whatever, and then eventually a finished piece. And I could deliver nothing at all. And in fact, for the last week, I mean, Elif talks about being scared today. I have been in a state of terror for about a week, ever since I actually sat down to engage with it, because I thought I kind of knew what I thought. And then, as happens when you sit down to actually make an argument or put your thoughts on paper, things turn out to be different. And so eventually it was actually finished and emailed at 1 o'clock in the morning, when I was due to take the plane at 6 in the morning. So here we are. So this is the first time I actually see it since that sort of last frenzy of writing. So in a sense, it's really as new to me as it is to you. Forgive me if I stumble while I read. So, should literature be political? The Writers' Conference held here at the Edinburgh Festival 50 years ago discussed this proposition. Many believe that the novelist has the duty to further, by his writing, the causes in which he believes. Others think that literature must be above the problems of the day. Well, let's put aside that whole little gender political thing there. The assumption is that the novelist is able to do one or the other. And I'm not sure that this assumption is true. Can a novelist deliberately sit down to write a novel that furthers a cause? Well, yes, and it may be a good cause and a just cause, but what you get, I think, will not be a novel. It will be a political tract with a veneer of fiction. It's been my experience that even when we think that we are choosing the story, it is the story that chooses us. George Eliot wrote, "If we had a keen vision and feeling for all ordinary human life, it would be like hearing the grass grow and the squirrel's heart beat, and we should die of the roar which lies on the other side of silence." Today, there is no other side, and there is no silence. The internet, Twitter, and YouTube have made sure of that. Yes, the noise may be removed from our immediate circle, but we know that it exists. We know that it will take two taps on the keyboard to bring our screen chiming to life with trafficked women, terrorized children, and desperate men. We know that men and women brave seas and deserts in search of a livelihood. We know that half the world goes hungry, and the planet is crazed with man's excess, and that there is, particularly among the young, a great and urgent desire to change the system. The question is, do you want to engage with this, or do you want to escape it? Do you want to live your life in a bubble, or do you want to be part of the great narrative of the world? Is a novelist a literary activist? An activist is impelled by a cause and adopts it. Most people are content to live their lives within prescribed and personal boundaries. But the point, or one of the points, of artists, surely, is that they live outside their skin, that they're connected, that they hurt with the hurt of their fellow humans. How then can they disengage? How can you, if your task, if your gift is narrative, absent yourself from the great narrative of the world? Should the novel be political? I don't believe in should anywhere near art. At any moment, there are 1,000 stories to be told. Do we storytellers choose which one to tell, or are we chosen, pressed, and besieged by a story until we sit down and work on it and realize it and bring it forth into the world? Does the story come to us when we're ready to take it on? And isn't the only should, then, that we should give the story its due? I believe that our duty is to our reader and to the story we've agreed to tell. Our duty is to keep our readers reading, to let them into a world they can make their own, a world where they recognize their own questions and their own longings, where they find characters who become friends, and they feel such powerful empathy that they want to reach through the print to help or comfort them. That's the deal. The writer engages the reader's emotions, makes the reader care what happens next, and the reader engages with the world being presented. And by feeling for the novel's world, the reader validates it. Our duty is to help the story that's our duty is to help the story that's come to us to be told in the most effective way possible. But we don't choose the story. We are drawn in where the feeling is deepest. A work of fiction lives by empathy, the extending of myself into another's, the willingness to imagine myself in someone else's shoes. This itself is a political act. Empathy is at the heart of much revolutionary action. But the novelist, like the activist, is also a citizen of the world and bears the responsibility of this citizenship. The question is, then, can you honor your responsibility as a citizen of the world and fulfill your responsibility to your art? The question becomes critical in times of crisis. Mahmoud Darwish, the late great Palestinian poet, in his address to the opening event of the first Palestine Festival of Literature in 2008, wrote of the difficulty of being a Palestinian writer who has to use the word to resist the military occupation and has to resist on behalf of the word, the banal and the repetitive. How can he achieve literary freedom in such slavish conditions? And how can he preserve the literariness of literature in such brutal times? The questions are difficult, but we try to tease out answers. Darwish's answer, perhaps, was to absent himself from the center of the crisis. That center was, for him, his hometown of Haifa. So he kept an office in Ramallah, but lived mostly in Amman. At that distance, he could produce the work that was both true poetry and true to the situation. But what if you cannot or will not remove yourself from the situation? In Egypt, in the decades of slow, simmering discontent before the revolution, novelists produced texts of critique, of dystopia, of nightmare. Now we all seem to have given up, for the moment, on fiction. Fiction will come again, I hope, and maybe I'll tell the story of Boulet Sands, not 1 kilometer from my home, where the police killed Amr al-Bunni last week, and the community is being terrorized out of its homes to make way for a luxury development. Or maybe I'll tell the story of Samira Ibrahim, who put a stop to the military's virginity tests, or Ahmed Harara, whom they shot in one eye on the 28th of January and in the other in December. Or Layla, Khalid Saeed's mother, who's adopted all the young revolutionaries in lieu of her murdered son. Or attempts at fiction right now would be too simple, too black and white. The immediate truth is too obvious, too glaring, to allow a more subtle truth to take form. For reality has to take time to be processed, to transform into fiction. So it's no use a story presenting itself, flirting, tempting, asking to be written, because another story will in the next minute come roaring over it, making the same demand. And you, the novelist, can't grab one of them and run away and lock yourself up with it and surrender to it and wait and work for the transformation to happen, because you, the citizen, need to be present, there on the ground, marching, supporting, talking, instigating, articulating. Your talent at the time of crisis, I believe, is to tell the stories as they are, to help them to achieve power in this world as reality and not as fiction. Thank you.
Thank you, AHDAF. You gave us so many thoughts that matter so much to all of us. Allow me to ask, actually, with one of the points you have just made. You know, at times like this, when it's...
At times like this, I need a cigarette.
Or a drink.
But I can't have one, so it's all right.
Or a drink. At times like this, fiction is fiction. Perhaps a luxury, you know? Does it look like a luxury? As a matter of fact, I don't think it's a new question. It is an old question, and it was asked after Auschwitz, right? Adorno had asked it. Frankfurt School political scientists had asked this question, and they had said, could there be poetry after Auschwitz? You know, they were struggling with that question. Is poetry still meaningful after you have seen so much violence and cruelty and perhaps you lost your hope in humanity? Is it still meaningful? I want you to elaborate on that. You know, when is it, in your opinion, not the right time for fiction?
No, I don't think of it like that. I don't think it's a luxury. In fact, I think it would be an amazing contribution, and I think it would be an activist contribution, and I think it would be useful if a novel were to appear, if somebody were actually able to write a proper novel, not a political tract disguised as a novel, but a truly imagined and felt novel of the Egyptian Revolution now. I think that would be a contribution. I don't see how it can be done, because the novelist who is able as an artist to do that will be unable. It's a logistical problem that you cannot be in two places and two modes of being at once. You can't be engaged with what's happening and with actually being part of it on the ground every day, and also be removed enough and take the time to give a work of fiction the time and the attention and the concentration that it needs. But it's not a matter of luxury, it's just I don't see how it's possible to happen.
So do I hear you right? I mean, while things are happening, while they're taking place, it's harder to find the time for fiction, but essays, nonfiction, commentary comes more naturally. I think it was Doris Lessing who reminded us that literature was, you know, written after the event. It was analysis after the event. So at the moment, there's no time to make that analysis.
Again, it's not so much a matter of analysis. It's a matter of being able to give it, to give the enterprise the mental and the emotional space for the facts to turn into fiction, for patterns to be formed, for characters to be fully imagined and realized. I mean, you sometimes spend days not actually producing a sentence, but going through a process which eventually results in producing a sentence. Mm-hmm. And if you can't do that, if you can't have that mental and emotional and physical space, then I don't see how. I mean, basically, like, I believe, God forbid, that if I were taken away and locked up now in a very comfortable jail with a desk lamp and, you know, electricity and so on for a year, I would produce the novel. But I'd have to be locked away, because I can't choose to absent myself from what's happening on the ground.
I'd like to hear your thoughts about political novel, you know, what we mean when we talk about political novels, because it will be important for the following discussion. And today also is the anniversary of George Orwell's Animal Farm, the day it was published. I think it's worth remembering it. When we look at books like The Animal Farm, or obviously Kafka's, you know, The Trial, The Castle, or Ayn Rand's works, it's perhaps more easier to recognize them as political novels. But then there are some other works, perhaps more recent. Are they considered political novels in the same way? One example that comes to my mind immediately is Hisham Matar's beautiful The Anatomy of a Disappearance. It is a political novel, but is it a political novel? So what is your definition of a understanding of a political novel?
Well, I think that's something that also will be interesting to hear from everybody about, because I think people have varying definitions, and they're all equally valid. For some people, a political, you know, when you say a political novel, what they think of is, you know, something like The West Wing, or, you know, but then you could actually extend the definition. I mean, for me, I mean, is George Eliot a political novelist? I mean, I think that Middlemarch is a political novel in that it deals with, you know, a character who has, I mean, all the problems, the tragedy of her life is because of the limitations that were in place for women at the time. And the novel says this. It says that if Maggie were the boy and Tom were the girl, the Tullivers, then things would have been much simpler. It deals with the changing society where power is going from the mill owner and the landowner to, you know, the lawyers and the financiers, and so on. And so that is political. So it really depends how. I mean, I know that ultimately you could even say that with escapist fiction or with Mills and Boone, you know, is that political? Well, it probably is political. It's political in the resolute absence of world politics, but it's also political in the relationships within, that the man is always sort of richer and taller and older, for example, than the woman. And you know, so where does politics stop?
Yeah, I guess what I'm trying to understand is, has the definition of political novel changed throughout time? Is there a universal definition or a timeless definition? Or maybe that too is undergoing change, some kind of change. And perhaps we should also mention, before we go further, what we mean by politics, right? Because politics could be everywhere. Politics could be defined in a broader way. In my opinion, in my personal opinion, it's one of the things that we owe women's movement, especially second generation feminist movement. They taught us that the private is also political, which is an important contribution. But then that said, there are scholars like Terry Eagleton who have criticized, saying it's one thing to say, you know, politics is everywhere or everything is political, but then it's something else to recognize that not everything is political in the same way. So how do we make these distinctions? Do they matter? And if they matter, what are our priorities or your priorities? Where do you focus when you talk about looking at politics?
Well, I'm not a theoretician or a political analyst. I'm a novelist, a writer who happens to be in a situation where politics is sort of very much, where public politics, I mean big politics, is center stage and has to be dealt with. So I see politics in almost all relationships. I mean, maybe, you know, parents and little tiny babies, perhaps, is free of politics. But otherwise, I think relationships are political. And for me, as a novelist, even though that has been a very long time, what interests me, of course, is character and is relationships between characters. And politics, both big and small, come into it. And, you know, without really wanting to talk about myself, but the big or example for me is that in The Map of Love, I had to find a language that Anna and Sharif, Anna is my heroine, who is an English lady at the beginning of the 20th century, and Sharif al-Baroudi is the man she falls in love with, and he's an Egyptian nationalist, and it's a time when, of course, British colonial power is in Egypt, so you can see the potential for conflict and tension in that relationship. And these two people who are falling in love have to find a common language, and they decide that they will speak to each other in French, because there it's a level ground, and they absent themselves from the relationship, you know, of the relationships of power in their languages. So, you know, for me as a novelist, it comes up in relationships and is part of the world that interests me and that I try to engage with.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Can I just move the discussion towards the audience, towards the participants? On that note, it makes me think, perhaps as a Turkish writer, it's a personal question for me as well, because in Turkey, politics is so heavy. It's such a politicized and polarized country in many ways. So it makes me wonder, are there any regional differences? Or in other words, are writers coming from certain parts of the world more engaged or have to be more engaged in politics, do you think? And I want to share with you a quote that I'm hoping we could discuss afterwards. It's from Chinua Achebe. And it says, "It is clear to me that an African creative writer who tries to avoid the big social and political issues of contemporary Africa will end up being completely irrelevant, like that absurd man in the proverb who leaves his burning house to pursue a rat fleeing from the flames." So when there are more urgent matters, when your house is, right, burning, maybe that is the definition of political writing. In this perspective, do you agree with this? Do you think there is a distinction for authors from certain parts of the world, mostly from outside the Western world? It is an urgency to deal with these burning houses. Carmina, may I ask your opinion about that?
Do you need to wait for mine?
Yes. I think so.
It's coming.
Thank you.
speaking personally, there's often a feeling of urgency, but I think AHDAF, you know, articulated very well the way a story gets away from you. I thought I was writing a novel which would be set in Peshawar in 2009. It's set in Peshawar, but now it ends in 1930. But it still, to me, is, you know, around the same questions. But I think, you know, when you talk about whether there are regional differences, I think there's a question to do with the texture and fabric of the world you're writing about and from. A few months ago in The Guardian, there was an interview with Ann Tyler, which Lisa Allardyce did, and there's one point where Ann Tyler, you know, when she's asked about the fact that her novels contain very few political historical references, and I'm not saying I want Ann Tyler to write any differently, but she said, you know, even if I'm reading a historical novel, I get annoyed if people are sitting around a dining table discussing Napoleon. That's not how the world works.
Well, it does.
I thought that is how the world works. And if you're in Egypt when Napoleon's troops came in, you would be sitting around the dining table every evening talking about that. And you might be talking about it in a particular way. You might be talking about the rumor you heard that Napoleon is taking the Sphinx's nose back for Josephine, or an encounter in the marketplace with a soldier. Hmm. But you would definitely be talking about that every single mealtime.
Yeah.
It wouldn't be the only thing, but it would be there. And that's going to work into the dining tables of your novels. I think the other thing is, you know, I think for those of us in certain parts of the world, we go to novels with questions. We go to novels, you know, the idea that novelists have answers always seem odd to me.
Yeah.
We just have questions, and I think we go to novels to try and look at those. And I don't know how to get away from the question of what happened to my country.
Yeah.
So somehow that's, you know, even if I start with something completely different and very small around a dining table, in some way, I'm certainly going to see that question in the novel, even if it's not the only question, and even if not all the readers see it there.
Yeah. Would anyone else like to comment on that? Please.
Maybe the mic,
yeah.
My name's Alan Gibbons, I write young adult fiction. I think you put it right when you said kind of politics chooses us. The very act of writing can be political. People can be jailed or tortured for saying political opinions. In the very comfortable, relatively comfortable world we live in Britain, we're having to fight to keep libraries open. The very place, the temple of the book, in the seventh richest country in the world, the most philistine government in 100 years, is trying to dismantle the public library service. To just exist as a writer has demanded that many of us take a political commitment. But it's not taking a political commitment just to defend us, if you want, as selfish writers. I think it is the conclusion of vulture capitalism. It's the conclusion of globalised markets. And when the West is declining, fractures appear. One of the fractures, a lot of people have said how wonderful it was to see Jessica Ennis wearing her Union Jack and Mo Farah. And it was wonderful because it's a different statement when they do it, if you want, newly immigrant Britons within the last 3, 4, 5 generations, than when a nationalist, a member of the English Defence League, a racist wears it. However, I come from an Irish background, and I would rather spit on that flag than wear it round my shoulders, and I never will. I see myself as a citizen of the world. And basically, I think the issue of omission and commission is central. What stories are you going to tell? Because I think many people look around and they saw the rioters, and it was controversial. The BBC banned it. Should the rioters tell their stories, or should only official society and the police? The duty of writers, I think, is to cut against the grain of official society and to say that if riots occurred that tore across London, Manchester, Salford, there is a duty on the writer to find a way to say that story with as much passion, to internalise it and make it real and 3D and evocative and provocative as we can. So I believe absolutely literature cannot help but be political.
Please. Yeah.
I'm Alan Bissett from Scotland. We're living in a period of global class struggle that has become apparent in the last few years. So It's not incumbent upon any particular country to be more politically engaged than others. It's a responsibility of anybody, anywhere. Mm-hmm. And I think the question shouldn't be framed, should literature be political? Literature is political all the time. Literature's about society. Society is composed of politics. Mm-hmm. It's just how high we put the politics up in the mix, which is what you were discussing. Mm-hmm. Sometimes the absence of politics is itself political. Louise Mensch, for example, is a political writer. She's just reaffirming the status quo. And I think there is a place for novels that put politics very high up in the mix, in which the art and ambiguity and irony and even psychological depth are secondary to the message. That would be Animal Farm, that would be The Ragged Trouser Philanthropist, that would be One Day in the Life of Ivan Denisovich, it would be The Grapes of Wrath, in which it's very clear what the writer's message is, and they're guiding us towards a particular conclusion. That shouldn't be the only kind of novel that's written, but I certainly think that shouldn't be one that's devalued.
Yeah, thank you. Ben, please.
I think this is a much more complicated subject than we're at this moment given credit for. And I've got two particular tacks that I want to take. I think first of all, when your house is burning, I think your first job is to put the fire out. And I'm not being metaphorical here. If you have a burning house and you put the fire out, you don't write. They're two different things. After you've put the fire out and you built a new house, then you can write about the fire that you put out. But you don't write as a way of putting out the fire. You put out the fire. And in terms of what AHDAF was saying, putting out the fire is physical, personal, individual activism. You take part in society as an individual. It's struggles, it's failures, it's conflicts. You take part as a citizen. That is putting the fire out. But writing literature is a completely separate activity and requires different skills, requires a time frame, requires many other complicated things. So the second part of what I'm trying to say is that literature can only be political if it is, first of all, literature. So the most important thing there is not political, it's literature, which is to say we're only interested in a work of literature that is political primarily because it is literature, which is to say it survives, it continually engages us as human beings way past the time that the actual events that the novels are writing about have gone past. So it actually has something in it that has the rich orchestra of humanism, of one's individual reading. It continually speaks to us, it continually reinvents itself in our imagination, and it continually poses questions to society. So if it is not literature first, it cannot be literature, it cannot be political. So I think, for me, the important thing here is to stress the orchestra of what constitutes literature. The depth and the richness of writing. Is Ulysses, for example, a political novel? Absolutely. But that is not primarily what it is. The novels, the works of art, the writing that we try to do that aim to be primarily political fall into the danger, and I've witnessed this a great deal in the literature that came out in Nigeria from the 60s to the present day. So many novels were written with the best intentions to try and put the fire out, as it were, and what happened after 5 years is that they became footnotes. We didn't understand what they were talking about because they were political, but they were not literature.
I'm Kirsty Gunn, UK. I'd very much like to pick up that point Ben made, and also I think we've got issues here with some of our definitions, because we've been talking about novels and literature, as Ben just pointed out, in the same breath. Mm-hmm. Now, the novel is a bourgeois artifact. It exists, it sits between the marketplace and the maker, the producer, and we are seeing more and more of this kind of commodification of what perhaps used to be a work of art. However, there is another kind of book that is a work of art, and perhaps this is where we should be keeping our word literature for that, whereby every decision that's made, every word that's put down on the paper, is a political one in the sense that the writer is taking enormous risks with herself, no matter what those risks are, whether they're to do with defending certain personal rights or whether these things are aesthetic. So I would love to see the conversation extending into that area as well.
I wanted to go back actually to that same metaphor, analogy, whatever it is.
Please.
Sorry, my name's Preeta Summerson. I'm not standing up. I'm 8 months pregnant and I'm sitting down. I'm from Malaysia. But I wanted to go back to what Ben was saying about the house being on fire. I was at another conference, literary festival recently in France where I live, and there was a question from a member of the audience, or I can't remember, maybe from one of the moderators, about why, you know, now that there's been an Arab Spring, can we expect similar revolutionary movements in Southeast Asia, where I'm from, or, you know, elsewhere in the world? And there was a young writer from Madagascar who gave a beautiful response to that. He said, you know, here we are, we're talking about, you're waiting for, like, a Southeast Asian Spring or a South Asian Spring, but all of these people in the audience are going to leave, and when you leave here, you're going to fill up your car at Texaco, you're going to put your little plastic cup in the correct, you know, bin and feel good about it. And I'm asking you, when is there going to be a European Spring? And I really think that there's a great deal to that, because we talk about, if you're going to talk about the house of African writers being on fire, I mean, really, it's our house. It's a house we all share. And I think to talk about African writers or Asian writers or Southeast Asian writers, having an obligation to put out that fire before they chase the rat, whereas a writer from Europe or America having the luxury, really, to write about other things, non-political things, I think that I wonder really whether it's not, it comes down to just another way of entrenching white privilege. I mean, it really is a house that we all share, regardless of what region we happen to be born in, or regardless of these accidents of birth.
Can I just say, think it's quite dangerous to talk in prescriptive terms about literature or about the novel, because, I mean, you cannot demand of a Swiss writer that they feel the pain of Africa and write about that. If they do, they do. If they don't, they don't. And we can only like their work as, well, Ben was saying, really, in as far as it is literature. Is it a good novel? Does it grab me? Does it give me a few hours of being away from the Egyptian Revolution, actually, so that I can catch my breath and go back to it? And so I think that you know, what one does should be really, you know, to sort of take stock of what the scene is and to describe it and then to work out what it means, rather than to demand that people do one thing or another, perhaps.
Please, I'm sorry, just behind. My name is Chika Onugu, I'm Nigerian. I think the fact of the matter is that if you come from a certain region of the world, for example, if you come from Nigeria, you're not being told what to write about. But you sort of feel a certain obligation put on yourself, by yourself, to write about certain things. Yeah. You feel like you do not have the privilege, for example, of writing, say, a novel like on Chesil Beach, you know. Yeah. I don't have the luxury of writing a novel where people just, you know, sit at the beach and, you know, dance and sing all day. There is that sort of obligation that you feel. It's almost like self-censorship, in a way, that you sort of censor what you write about without anybody having to tell you. So it's a bit like your house is on fire and your first obligation is to find ways of putting out that fire before you start searching for the rat, which would then be the luxuries.
My name is Angus McNichol. I write in, I'm a poet rather than a novelist. I write in English, I write in Lowland Scots, but my first language and the one in which I'm best known in Scotland is, as a poet, in Scots Gaelic. And there are fewer than 100,000 of us left. There have been attempts by governments over centuries to extirpate our language. Yeah. And the 1872 Education Act, which made education compulsory in Scotland, did not acknowledge the existence of the Gaelic language. There have been progressive developments since then. We now have Gaelic medium schools across the country, and there is a degree of hope that the language might begin to revive. If we get the young kids enthused, then there is hope. But to me, the question, should literature be political? The very act of writing. When I write a poem, I write in order to find out what I have to say. A lot of what I have to say reflects the experience I've had, the history that was denied me when I was at school that I spent years recovering. So inevitably, there is politics in the writing, but the important thing is really to make the poem work. I would agree with what everyone else is saying about literature must be literature first.
Yes.
You engage with the politics of your experience and don't feel that you're in any way limited by your experience. What matters is putting your own experience and the experience of your environment into literature. I would, in that context, like to ask yourself, being from a linguistic minority in this country, I'm very much aware that there is a cultural and linguistic minority in Turkey and across one of the greatest non-independent states, in effect, in the world, is the Kurdish state that does not exist. What status does Kurdish have in Turkey?
In Turkey, you mean?
Yeah.
It's it is quite complicated.
The Kurdish language.
It is complicated because, you know, being divided into four different countries in Syria, in Iran, in Iraq, and then Turkey, and inside Turkey also there are, you know, lots of dialectics. But the main problem, of course, is I think the Kurdish language has for a long time been denied. There was a time when in Turkey people could not even speak, you know, prisoners could not talk to their mothers in Kurdish, when their mothers came to visit them. I mean, let alone having an education in their mother tongue, let alone reading anything in their mother tongue. And I find it very ironic that many Turkish nationalists say that Kurdish language is a very primitive language, that it has not developed at all, it has a very limited vocabulary. You don't allow a language to develop, you deny its existence, you know.
Lived with that for generations as well.
Yeah, absolutely.
Our greatest poet, Sorry McLean, no longer with us sadly, Seamus Heaney, Nobel Prize winner, said many, many times, Sorry McLean should be a Nobel Prize winner. He is a great international poet in an ostensibly limited language, so I know exactly what you're
talking about. And I don't know if it's similar here as well, but in Turkey, my observation is women have kept so many of those old words, and they have transmitted them to their, you know, children and grandchildren. It's amazing. I mean, the oral culture within the Kurdish population is so strong, and that has resisted. The written culture is now developing faster. There was a written culture, now it's picking up again. But in between, I think the oral culture, you know, held everything together, and that means the domain of women mostly in Turkey.
My name is Yana Teller, and I'm a Danish novelist. And most of my Danish colleagues, if others were here, 99% probably would say that literature should not be political.
No,
because we live in a very sheltered country that has not gone through many catastrophes. And most people's experience, you know, the biggest catastrophe is maybe their parents got divorced or something. And that's what then is the catastrophe in the literature. But I happen to be multicultural, and my background is different. So I think differently of this. My mother came from Austria as a war child, and my grandfather, my father's side, was an immigrant from Germany and walked to Denmark to make a living after the First World War. And then I've lived a lot in Africa and other countries. So I definitely agree with everybody who has said literature in itself is political, the act of writing it is political, and that one cannot run away from the social conditions of what we write about. Yet, to pick up on what Ben said, what does make literature before it's political? Because that's where the crux, I mean, we can keep talking about, oh yeah, it's nice that it's political, but what is it actually that makes it literature first? And to my mind, when I see, why can we read today Dostoevsky across the world? Why can even Danes who haven't been in Africa can actually read Ben Okri and sympathize with his Asara and the world of spirits that they have no knowledge about? It's somewhere that when we, as novelists, use the specifics of the characters we create, we create a shape that the reader can identify with. And it's not a reader, let's say an English reader, who identifies with his Englishness. No, you take off your outside identity codes of nationality, of gender, of titles, of learning and so on, age, everything. And you enter not just the characters that are in the literature, but you enter the space, the universe. So, and it's that identification that real literature permits. And somehow, it's like the literature, I feel, when it's real literature, creates a coat that that undressed eye of the reader can go in and become. Mm-hmm. And if you do political literature where the politics come first, whether for good social causes or really bad nationalistic causes, as we saw in the Balkans in the 90s, mm-hmm. for example, the coat comes first. And there's no real identification of the undressed eye. Only those who agree with the coat can go in and say, yes, I am also either good or bad or with these people. Mm-hmm. And so I think that's this thing where we can see the fault line goes. Can we identify when we take out or take off our own identity codes?
Yeah.
And the other point there, to come back to where the market, as I think, is the real challenge in the industrialized world today, it's because if you want to write literature that, you know, gets people to really identify, not just because you write about whiskies and parties on the beach or so, but really identify with the inner being,
yeah.
it's actually often an uncomfortable thing, because we live in a world that so much prioritizes very superficial values, and where there's very little room for that sense of what is right as a human being. And so if you write for that and about that, you're often writing yourself into oblivion.
Oblivion, yeah.
And the Croatian writer Dubravko Bresic has written a wonderful collection of essays, Thank You for Not Reading, which is exactly about that. When they wrote in Eastern Europe before the fall of the Iron Curtain, they often wrote, yeah, in oblivion, but they had this hope that the Western world would, you know, this paradise would discover them at some point. But you would either, yeah, comply with the totalitarian authorities, or you would be an unknown. Today, the market works as a totalitarian authority, that you have to run into, oh, what everybody want to read, and then you get known and you have to be seen and to write about these things that are just up. Right now is sex, apparently, and so everybody is supposed and asked by their publishers that we should write about this. But if we don't comply with the market yet, there is no so-called paradise on the other side where we will be discovered. I believe in time and that this era hopefully will finish soon.
It will change.
We'll get to the other side. But, I hope my publishers will for a little while also.
AHDAF, may I come back to you on that note? When I read your work, especially, of course, Cairo, my city, our revolution, there's this amazing love for your city. You know, I always sense that in your talk, so much so that you mentioned how you resisted writing this book, but in a way the circumstances pushed you in that direction. Now, following up on the previous comment, how important is for you that sense of belonging, and in addition to that, a sense of identity, both national identity, but also belonging? Or do you make a distinction between this? Is it the city itself that is your anchor?
At the moment, this moment being about a year and a half now, I find it very hard to go from the particular felt experience into a general statement. And so I can't even say anything about national identity. I mean, we in Egypt are caught up in a what seems to us to be an enormous kind of end of days battle to save the soul of our country and allow it to sort of carry on existing in the world. Obviously, I'm involved in that. Now, on the other hand, as I was flying in and I saw sort of items of news about bank regulation, for example, and how sort of one, you know, the Lib Dems are talking about possibly sort of not allowing the instruments that were missold to be, you know, and they were. What I mean is that there is also a struggle for the soul of this country, but it is much less apparent. It's not people being killed on the streets, and yet, I guess if one was living here and there wasn't another place that was, you know, calling you, as it were, then that would also be very much a battle. I mean, I know that things like the NHS and the sort of sneaky privatization of it was a campaign that a great many of us were very, very much involved in. And so I think that the issue is sort of wider than the politics of identity. I think that, you know, as someone said, there is a global problem right now about who is it that owns the world and who is it that runs it and for whose benefit is it being run and what's going to happen to it and what's going to happen to the generations to come. And that battle is happening everywhere, but with, you know, more or less visibility and more or less subtlety, and therefore more, you know, involvement with people. And I guess I'm just more in that bit of it that's in Egypt right now because the house is on fire.
Yeah. Please.
Thank you. My name's China Mieville. I write mostly fiction. A question and an observation, both based on a concern I have, which is the focus on content as the axis for politics in fiction, which is not, of course, to disagree with the fact that that politics can be embedded in the content of fiction, often in very moving and important ways. But it raises two issues for me. And one is about form. And if you think, for example, about the explosion of artistic forms and experimentation after many social upheavals throughout history, I'm thinking particularly of the Russian Revolution, but you can think of many other examples. Simple question to AHDAF is, are you beginning to see on the ground in Egypt the explosion of a new revolutionary avant-garde,
yes.
You know, changes in language and so on? And I just ask the observation. I'd love to know the answer to that. And then the observation is that, again, as a corollary of moving away from the question of content, but this time actually moving away from the question of form as well, somebody pointed out quite rightly that the novel, you know, sits between the market and the reader and the writer, in fact, is a commodified form. The one kernel of hope that might give us is that that also means it becomes a cultural performance. And to this extent, literature, which I think most of us are agreed, is political, can be political irrespective of what the actual words in the book say. And my classic example of this is that I think the argument about cultural boycott of Israel in this country, I think the single largest, whichever side of that debate you come down on, I think that argument was given the single largest fillip in the last few years when Ian Banks declared in support of it in opposition to Operation Cast Lead. Now, Ian Banks, who's a fantastic novelist, writes about, you know, most people probably know him as, you know, books about spaceships and aliens and, you know, very, very wry sort of observations of Scottish life and so on. He does not write about Palestine. But the fact that he used the performance, the very commodified nature of his novels and said, I make this stance, literature then becomes political in a kind of meta way.
Yes. Yeah, I mean, just very briefly, yes, absolutely, the second point, I agree. And I mean, that's an interesting way, of course, of talking about the wider responsibility of the artist and so on. And of course, musicians have done this as well, you know, and have, and that has been tremendously important. And it's been important precisely because, as you said, that Banks' work was not particularly about Palestine. And so there was somebody from a much broader choosing to take this stance, which was very, very important. On the ground, the biggest and most transformative thing that we've had is in street art, in graffiti. It has been incredible, and of course immediate, but also interestingly, you actually saw a sort of artistic development that was totally in tandem with what was happening on the ground, which was political. So briefly, you had when the young man Khaled Said, who was killed before the revolution, and there was graffiti of him, there was a stencil of his head that became very famous and very iconic and was sprayed all over the Ministry of the Interior, which had killed him. And then when they started killing other young people, then the first one who actually got graffiti of comparable iconic stature was Mina Daniel, the Coptic activist who was killed in Maspero. With Mina's killing, because that was a really big deal, his graffiti kind of started to grow and develop, so that instead of being just a head, it became a head and a body, or it became a head with decorative elements around it. And eventually, it became Mina sitting on the ground with angel wings, which was a very Coptic, very Byzantine image. Shortly afterwards, in the event of the cabinet office, Sheikh Ahmed Aifat was killed. And he was a sheikh, he was a Muslim sheikh, he was very popular, he was in his 40s. So the graffiti that appeared of him was sitting and then standing in a sort of preaching pose with Quran, but with the Coptic angel wings, completely outside the Islamic tradition. And from there on, there was a whole eruption. We started getting pharaonic drawings, great big murals with pharaonic drawings mingled with contemporary, very contemporary abstract, wonderful one of women carrying the butane gas cylinders. There's a tremendous shortage of butane gas cylinders, and meanwhile we are exporting gas to Israel at cost price, which is a tremendously sore point. And so there was this wonderful structure of women carrying butane gas mingled with the pharaonic, mingled with the Byzantine and the Quran. It has been absolutely remarkable and transformed the streets of downtown, and was also, like, you know, the military put up walls to break off districts from each other, and they were then covered in graffiti and often covered in trompe d'oeil, which made them look as though you could walk through them. So that has been the single most remarkable thing that we've had.
How about with poetry? Because you have such an old tradition of poetry.
Absolutely. Yeah. I mean, poetry has been very much there, very much at the front of action, and poems, new poems have been written in the streets and have been sung in the streets. I don't know that the formal innovation of those is something that would not have happened without the revolution. You know, I think that in the case of poetry and music, the developments that have happened have been quicker and more intense. But with the graffiti, it just wouldn't have even happened. Mm.
Please. Yeah.
Sorry, I'm going to stand up just to let some steam off here for a second. a bit of pacing. I will. Sorry, you and Morrison, novelist and commentator. I take issue with the idea that all literature or literature is by definition political. I think we have to look at some of the great failings of literature, which has tried to be political, and also just ask ourselves. You know, if I say I'm being political right now, am I having any political repercussions in the world? Herbert Marcuse in the 1960s coined a term which was called repressive tolerance, which basically means that society encourages us to verbalize how we feel. We get to shout about the government and, you know, what they're doing over there and bombings and all the rest of it, and nothing happens. We've just expressed it, but there's no political repercussions from it whatsoever. So I'd like for us to look also at the failings of certain moments in the history of literature. For example, in the 1960s, there was a very language-based mode of critiquing the world. So for example, we thought that William Burroughs' cut-up technique was exposing and undermining the patriarchal bourgeois constructs of society. We thought as well within separatist essentialist feminism that writing the female body was destroying patriarchal language. And within Scottish nationalism, we believed, or the independence movement, that speaking our own vernacular was subverting the British global dominance. I think we'd all agree that those projects have historically failed. The second point is, in the last 2 years, there's been a superabundance of books about Wall Street traders. Has this in any way affected what has gone on in global politics? Well, no, it's not. It's an act of repressive tolerance. It's the failure of the novel to do anything
political. I would say the novel is overstretched in trying to deal with it. The one form I think does work and has worked historically is the allegory. With that, I mean, 1984, for example, we use, even when we're discussing the internet and Google and our smartphones and are they destroying the way we think, we talk about Big Brother. We talk about doublethink in politics. We use the language of allegory. It's become part of our political discussion. Just, you mentioned earlier on, Ayn Rand, Atlas Shrugged. Now, this is an astounding book which has had massive political repercussions. One of the men who read this book, which advocates the virtues of selfishness and which is all about destroying government intervention, was Alan Greenspan. Yeah. Alan Greenspan, the head of the Federal Reserve through various different administrations. What I would argue is political effectiveness for the book is possible. It certainly happened with this. Now, if on the left, I'm assuming most of us are left liberals, we want to do something, we might want to come up with an alternative to this, which is still pervasive to this day in its malignant force. Thank you very much.
May I have your thoughts on that? I see your hands, yeah. Yeah, I think you're going to need a mic, yeah.
Hi. It kind of goes off... Ooh, I need to find my seat first. What the gentleman at the front has just said, and it was something that was raised right at the beginning of the statement, and it was that even if he wanted to make a novel political, would it be possible... just because it's not literature first. Mm-hmm. And I wonder, from the reader's perspective, can we determine what the reader will actually take from a novel anyway? So as someone in the audience, I'd like to ask the writers, what is the responsibility of the reader, or the role of the reader?
That's beautiful. Yeah. Please, yeah.
We're talking about original intention and what you intend to put in a novel and whether or not you intend to make it political. And I think we're conflating two things. We're conflating causative politics and reflective politics, which is what you're talking about. And I think also we're talking about the novel as if it springs fully formed into a social vacuum. Mm. And actually, a novel or any kind of narrative literature is interactive. It's formed in the space between the reader and the writer. Mm. And so Middlemarch is intensely political to us because of the way we read it.
Yeah.
And but it wasn't necessarily intended that way or read that way then. And also, we're talking about what's valid as literature being defined by its historicity. I don't think that's right. I think stories don't have to last 100 years to be valid. I write my name's Denise Miner, and I write crime fiction and comics as well. And I think ephemeral art is really valid, and we shouldn't demand that our names end up on a monument somewhere for our work to matter. It can matter now. We don't have to survive. Our name doesn't have to survive. Our brand, going back to what China was saying. And also, going back to what Kirsty was saying about the market, we're all published. We are all sanctioned by the market. That's really significant. We've all been through that filter of the market. Who's not being published? That's what's political. Who doesn't get through that filter of what is saleable? That's what we're always told. Is this saleable? I can't publish that. It's not saleable. There's no audience for that. How do we know there's no audience for that? And who, you know, publishers, everybody wants to employ people like them. So publishers are very monocultural. And how do we get other publishers? But I would like to hear from readers what they take from books, because I've read books like, I loved what you were saying about Mills and Boone and how entrenched that is. And what lots of people were saying about, you know, either Stanley Fish says there's no such thing as point of viewlessness, and it's a good thing too. And Orwell said that mm-hmm. your work appears apolitical if it chimes with the status quo, and mm-hmm. if it doesn't, it's political. And for example, I'm a crime writer, and I always have a female protagonist. And mm-hmm. for about 10 years, I was asked why I was so political. And I started writing, not so much anymore, not since the killing, but thank you, Denmark. You know, I mean, I think that's really significant. And I started writing because I was principally motivated by politics, because I kept reading American crime novels where
bad guy was shot at the end without a trial, and this was justice somehow. And I applied for a job on a magazine called Take a Break, which some of our international visitors may not have heard of, but it's a women's magazine, because this is who the women's movement was not speaking to. Who are we not speaking to? And anyway, so I'd like to hear from the audience, because I think that's really significant, what people take from books, if they take it as an affirmation. And also, I'd like to bring up the issue of just world beliefs. There's a fundamental human need to believe that the world is fair. And the danger is that we stop looking at how it's not fair because it's too sore. And so, you know, you're talking about the house being on fire. What do we do if our neighbour's house is on fire? What do we do if four houses down is on fire? Do we help? Or is it just exhausting? And how do we sustain that into middle age? Because when you're young, it's easy to empathise, but when you're a bit older, you get tired. You need to sustain that passion.
I would love to direct your questions to the audience, but I would also like to ask you a personal question. I was very intrigued by the things you said. And coming from a country, again, like Turkey, where the novel, particularly as a genre, has been so important in triggering social change, social transformation, because since the time of late Ottoman Empire, throughout the Republican era, novelists, more than you know, other artists, and the novel as a genre has been used as to generate you know more modernization, more westernization. And as a matter of fact, there are people, there are literary scholars who believe that due to this, the characters in Turkish novels, early Turkish novels, were not very well developed because we were always looking for the demon outside of us, never questioning the demon inside the individual. I'm very intrigued by that interpretation. And one other interpretation is because of that, and because we were always so involved in politics and generating political transformation, crime novels have not ever found the ground in Turkey to develop. I'm just curious, what's your take on that? I mean, when I look at countries like Turkey, Morocco, India, Pakistan, we don't see science fiction as a very robust tradition, literary tradition, or we don't see crime novels. Most crime novels, at least these days, you know, the most popular ones today are coming from countries where there's a more mature democracy and where people die of old age, not of calamities. Do you see that connection? Because I was very intrigued. You said you were inspired by politics. So what you're saying is changing that framework altogether.
I think that's fascinating. And I think crime fiction is, it really is a meta-narrative about the restoration of order. Mm. And I think in cultures where there is order, people see small variations on that and they want to read affirming narratives. But I think in cultures where there is absolute chaos, people don't read crime fiction. You don't read about violence in Darfur. If you're in a refugee camp, you don't want a mystery to be solved because the mystery is, why am I in a refugee camp? Yeah. So I think it is a luxury product. It is a luxury. It is a luxury. The luxury is peace, and that's what makes the narrative work. So I think I'm not surprised to hear that, and I think that's common the world over.
Yeah, please.
Didn't have to travel far. I'm Carlos Gamero from Argentina. And, well, I answer both of you. Argentina is not a country that is constantly in absolute chaos, but every now and then.
Yeah, absolutely.
We have a very robust tradition, both in science fiction and in crime fiction. Mm. Of course, our crime fiction might be different from the mainstream genre. I mean, I once set down 10 rules, a sort of decalogue for the Argentine crime fiction, especially after the dictatorship. Rule one was crime is always committed by the police. Rule two is the purpose of the investigation is to hide the truth. No, the third was the purpose of the legal system is to cover up for the police. You know, there is no room for deduction for the detective because the police have always been before him in the scene of the crime. Actually, there are no detectives because the detectives are either ex-cops or you know ex-secret service. So the investigation can only be carried out by a private citizen or a journalist, maybe. Mm. The purpose of the investigation will be never to obtain justice, maybe to reveal the truth, mm-hmm. if anybody is willing to hear. And we had a great example, Rodolfo Walsh, one of our great political writers. Actually, he died because of his opposition to the last dictatorship we had. He died in the 25th of March, 1977, after writing the first denunciation of the crimes of the juntas. It was an open letter of a writer to the military junta. And he began as a writer of crime fiction. He was writing what you would call analytical crime fiction, the English tradition, sort of, you know, closed rooms, corpses that appear, nothing political. His second work, which was in a way a direct continuation of his first book of sort of detective stories, was an investigation of the murder of followers of Perón following the deposition of Perón in 1955. He was deposed and his followers were murdered a year later for the anniversary. And he carried out the investigation himself as a journalist. And it was a clandestine book. It was he published it as nonfiction. It was a political book, definitely. But going back to this question of content and form and how a book should be political, 10 years later, after he published the book, he said, I reread it and I find sentences that irk me. I mean, I know that I could write a much better book now. I always thought it was fascinating. He was looking back on this clandestine book he had to write in a clandestine way, in a state of urgency, and he wasn't worrying about the evidence, the facts, or justice, but about sentences, words. I mean, that is a political writer for me, I mean, with the emphasis on writing. When he wrote the open letter to the junta, he was a hunted man. I mean, his comrades were being hunted down and massacred and thrown from planes into the river by the thousands. He was in charge of the information services of the Peronist guerrillas, so he was a very busy man. Still, when he was writing this open letter, he studied Cicero because he wanted to get the cadence of the sentences. He wanted the power of oral public speech into this clandestine written speech. And answering Sadaf for a minute, at the same time, he was writing a novel. He was writing a novel that went back 100 years in time. It seems that he thought he needed personally, at the same time, to fight the military junta in this very dangerous state he was in, to write a denunciation of their crimes, and to write a novel as a sort of balance to his more urgent activities as an activist. Well, I didn't want to repeat the word. Mm-hmm. So, well, I wanted to contest a few of the things that were being said here with this very concrete example. Thank you.
Thank you. I just want to say two things. I just want to say two things to pick up on some points that were made before they go too far away. One was when you said it's okay to be ephemeral. And I think that's great. And I'll admit that I suppose being sort of somewhat old-fashioned and classical in my approach to literature, I first came across this idea of it's okay to be ephemeral to do with the graffiti that I was just talking about, because there was a fight going on where the government would come down at night and sort of wipe out the graffiti, and then the kids would write thank you for the blank canvas and start again. And at one point, because of that one with the butane gas, I was so upset about it. And they said, that's fine, you know, the graffiti is meant to be ephemeral. It's part of it is that it's painted over and so on. And then an aside is that, of course, we have had already the Western collector who wants the bit of wall carved out so that it can be shipped over to New York or whatever. So it's, you know, just complete. I mean, it's just insane, that whole market thing and art and the market and so on. Over there, it was something about the responsibility of the reader. And I think that really, I mean, the responsibility of the reader is, it only starts really if they like the book and if they want to read it. And then the responsibility is to work with it, I guess. And the book in the end is, I mean, any book, any text, is only what the reader reads. It, you know, what is it otherwise? And I guess the better the book, the more different things different readers will take from it. And that is possibly one of the differences between, you know, what you call literature and what you call, you know, whatever, non-polemic or,
yeah, propaganda,
or bad
perhaps,
writing.
Yeah.
I think.
Please, yeah.
My name is Xu Chuan. I come from China, and I feel that this topic is getting more and more interesting. So, should literature be political when we ask this question? I think we take for granted that we are all in this room. We are all good people and kind people. We are
kind people
to talk about this topic. But I have other questions, like should literature be fashionist? That's also political.
Be what?
Should literature be Stalinist? That's also political. Sure. So it's I think this topic is, when I think about this topic, I always feel that it's very complicated. 30 years ago, when the Chinese writers, revolutionary writers, they were political. And later, after many years, they were abandoned because people feel that that's a wrong way politically. So when we talk about this, should literature be political? Actually, we are talking about should literature be correct or anything. So I feel that there are some hidden meanings here. That is, should literature be something to express your values, be something to show that you are a good man or a kind man, or you have morals. I know some writers and some poets, not in nowadays, but in history. Maybe a poet could be I'm a poet, so maybe a poet could be a devil. So if it's a devil politics, do we accept it? Yeah. And I think this is really
crucial. Can I ask
crucial.
A question? Can I just ask a question? Yes, of course, but okay.
Sorry, because I promised.
Mm. My name is Matthias Politiki from Germany, boring country. So we have no need to be political. Even though my name is Politiki. But I wonder if we are old-fashioned to think that authors should be still political. I was raised with Willy Brandt's politics and all this zeitgeist who, well, even in school we were told, you have to go out in the street, demonstrate for whatever. And when I published my first novel, it was in 87, it was occasionally about the color of vowels, which is not really political. And after my first reading, a listener said, where's the political point in it? And I said, oh, should there be a political point in that? And then there was a riot, of course, there should. And my publisher then said to me, you never answer like that. You always say everything we do is political, and then you're on the safe side now. And I kept to that rule, and I was safe. But when I started writing essays on politics, and as there are not too many in Germany who do that, suddenly I was invited by politicians for their clandestine dinners together with two or three authors. And of course we discussed politics with them, and I thought, wow, that's it. Now I can change the world. And occasionally it happened that I spent an evening with Angela Merkel. And guess what happened? I kept trying to convince her for this and that. And she, you know her now, she just sits there. She sits and she waited till my time was out. So nothing happened. And nothing happened, and I went home and thought maybe I was just invited as a kind of fool to their court, to an entertainment, an ornament to their discussion. And so I'd like to raise the question, isn't it a bit megalomaniac to still believe in our mission, apart from writing good novels or good poems, to change the world? Yeah. If we have to do with Facebook on one hand, it was much faster and more efficient, and Merkel on the other side, completely different to Facebook.
Just, yes, okay.
Just I want to share something to follow up on that, and then we will please continue. It's I think it's a beautiful question, and does literature need to change people? Do we have that kind of mission? At the beginning of this conference, we talked about 1962 events, and I want to share with you a quote from Muriel Spark, because she answers that question in her own way, with her own style. She says, "I must tell you that I know nothing whatsoever about the novel as a genre, because I write them, and also I don't want to know. The more I know, the less I want to write. I'm very sorry to disagree, because there was a discussion at the time with the gentle and brilliant Mr. Durrell. He said that one of the things that he asked that a reader should ask of a novel is whether it had changed them. I think that for a novelist to try to change anybody, for anyone to try to change anybody, is horrible. The novelist should never forget the dignity of his calling and remember that he is a servant." So that was her take on that discussion. Please, yeah.
I'm John Birdside. I was accidentally born in Scotland. I wanted to respond to that. Maybe the question should be, should literature be dissident rather than political? Because my basic point of view is that I follow Emerson and believing that every actual state is corrupt. And therefore, our duty, and it is a duty, is to resist always. To all states and all of the corruption. And I think because we are citizens, and we're citizens who happen to be writers, then we use what we do to resist that corruption. And the point that Ewan was making earlier, you could collaborate with that system. You could be an Ayn Rand or someone like that. And you can collaborate with that system by being one of the writer who's got the three most best-selling books in the country at the moment. They all involve the word grey. You can collaborate with that, or else you can say, no, I won't collaborate with that, but I'll somehow try and sneak something different past the market, past the group of mainly male white editors in this country, certainly, sneak something past that, which is dissident.
Yeah.
And maybe that's our duty, rather than being political.
Rather than political, yeah, please.
Hi, my name's Nick Laird. I'm from Northern Ireland. I just want to agree with what John said, that it's difficult whenever you grow up in a country that has incredibly dominant political narratives and you go to school and you're told that you're a member of a certain tribe that maybe you feel reluctant about, or you go to church, or you turn on the evening news every night and you get fed this political narrative the whole time. And I think that there is a kind of onus on a young writer who comes to write the first novel at that time, and the onus is to complicate the narrative. And what you want to do is kind of introduce the paradoxes and confusions that you see every time you leave your house, but aren't represented at all. So that kind of political onus is different if you grow up in England, or maybe, you know, if you grow up in America, then I don't think you suffer from that. Whereas whenever you grow up in a place maybe like Israel or Palestine or Northern Ireland, it's very hard not to feel a responsibility to write about something, even if just to write from a dissenting position. Oh, thank you.
You need to give me a better hint.
Okay.
Juno.
Oh, down there.
What? Oh, yes, no? Please.
Thank you so much. My name is Juno Diaz. I'm from the Dominican Republic and the U.S. I guess I've really enjoyed the conversation and the way it's sort of, I think, explored a lot of the territory, but my sense is that there's primarily been arguments about what we like to read and what we like to write. Like, these seem to be mostly aesthetic propositions or propositions of ethos, where, so for example, I think the novelist should do this, or I think the novel should do that. But these are all really personal arguments, because the fact is that every single one of us could have an opinion of what we want to read and what we want to write, and it doesn't begin to cover what literature is. It doesn't begin to cover what people want to write and what people want to read. I mean, I'm sort of struck by the argument that the sort of rebuke that Ahmad had in theory to Frederick Jameson, where Frederick Jameson made this kind of wild claim about third world literature being by necessity national allegory. And Ahmad said to him some, you know, he made this real great claim. He's like, have you read novels in Urdu? Well, if you haven't read novels in Urdu, what the fuck do you know about third world literature? Which is to say that I love to read, I read endlessly, but I can't claim to have read more than 1% of novels. My sense of what literature is and what literature does is determined really by an incredibly limited reading experience. And that itself biased by sort of kind of canonical pressures that certain books we're told that are important because we're told they're important and we're more likely to read them. But again, my sense is that both what people want to write and what people want to read is so stupendously diverse that most of our claims around it tend to be just personal and they tend to be just like individualist, you know, aesthetic arguments. Where I think that, you know, a lot of people are like, I don't like to read stuff where it's really too obviously political. I'm like, knock yourself the fuck out, because plenty of people like to read that shit. There's a ton of people out there who like to read stuff. Ever read Fahrenheit 451?
Yeah.
Guys, that's not big on fucking character. The politics of that book is real, real clear, real transparent. Really, we would say at a level of literature, it's like brutalist architecture. You know? And yet, it's a book that has outlasted many books of its generation. I mean, I'm a genre reader. I love to read science fiction and fantasy. And there's an entire group of people out there who like to read books that are thought experiments. Book that basically take real just simplistic, sort of monolithic ideas and perhaps just a political stance. And it's real obvious what it is. There's nothing that you can sort of run and hide. And there's people that enjoy that immensely. And I guess my sense of it is, yes, I understand that there's sort of a tradition that the novel has to be some sort of incredibly complex thing where the artistic and the human needs to be so stupendously profound that we can connect over a 700-year period. But that's not everybody's reading experience, and that's certainly not everybody's writing experience. My sense of it is that, yes, there is plenty of stuff that is bad about political writing. Well, there's plenty of stuff that's incredibly bad about apolitical writing. And I guess personally as a reader, I know that I find most of my claims, even the one I'm making now, to be enormously just myopic, because what we're ending with always is that the amount of books, the amount of literature, what's being produced, and how little we know about what moves people. How little we know about what an artistic encounter inside of a person's subjectivity, how that will motivate them to attempt a praxis. I think we don't understand that very well. But we want to think we do. So I'm like, honestly, I really, when I think about the books that they found in, you know, when the sort of the grandma landed in Cuba and poor Fidel's little cadre of revolutionaries, so few of them got off the boat and weren't massacred, they found this enormous body of books that these guys had brought along. And most of the books were crap. They were junk. They were throwaway dreadfuls. You know, cowboy westerns written in Spanish. And yet, these were books that gave these gentlemen comfort. Perhaps some of them even gave them motivation. But it's really a mystery what motivates people and what puts people on the street and what produces a long-term praxis. And I guess that's my sense of it. While we could draw genealogies, there's plenty of people who have genealogies who said, I read fucking Marx and that's the reason I'm running this country now. There's other genealogies that are completely invisible and they're almost, you know, they're almost like just a profound secret where there's very little understanding of how it works. So I guess I wanted to keep it open to remember that any of these formulas by their nature are just mostly about how mysterious this entire thing is.
I want to get back to the audience, but before that, I think we have an online question.
We have a number of online questions. Our audience is from far away as Australia to as close as sitting in the garden outside.
come in.
We have online delegates as well, including the author Harry Kundrew, who's stating that he feels that literature is already irredeemably political, regardless of the intention of the writer or the reaction of the state. But a follow-up question from another online audience member is, are we not preaching to the converted here? What about those who completely disregard literature that cause atrocities, and how do we reach them?
through television series? Please.
May I make a historical comment? I was present for all 5 days of the conference in 1962.
Ooh.
And should literature... so was John. Should literature be political, in 1962 was construed as whether it should further the Marxist-Leninist ideology. That's what was meant by it. Hugh McDermott repeatedly said, yes, of course. The fact is, he never managed to do so, is neither here nor there. He kept on saying, yes, it should do so. Lots of other people said, no, it shouldn't be that. And they were equally taking up an ideological point of view. It's fascinating today that nobody has, in fact, formulated that as the nature of that question, but has taken it up really as, can literature be apolitical? Everybody says no. Should literature be apolitical? Almost everybody said no. It's a huge difference in, shall we say, the thinking about literature in this last 50 years.
Thank you so much. I really regret, you know, having to stop this conversation. It's so beautiful. We have so many wonderful things to talk about. Owen, may I invite you to do the most difficult thing now and wrap up the conversation.
Yes, great. Summarize that. Thank you very much, everyone. But thank you very much for all of the contributions that we've had. I should say that when I looked at the conference, I saw that this was the first conversation that we've been having. I think that I was actually concerned on a couple of fronts. One being that there'd been an awful lot of talk about 1962, about how that conference put a bomb under writing in Scotland and had actually some very, very far-reaching consequences. And yet I was aware that the form of this conference was so different. It's a much more a chaperoned affair, you might say. We don't have as many people in the room, but we have many, many more people online. At this point, you can jangle your iPads, to sort of paraphrase John Lennon. And so I did wonder if... thank you, John. So I did wonder if the actual nature of the debate would be somewhat curtailed. But I think that, you know, from the vibrancy of the ideas that we've heard, that thankfully that hasn't been true. The other concern I had was actually with that single word in the question, should. As far as I'm concerned, the only should that literature needs to be concerned with is that it should be good, it should be interesting, and it should be interested. And it was partly for that reason that I was so pleased that in the opening address, the address was very much answering the paragraph of questions that were asked in 1962, which were a series of questions around why and how should a writer socially engage. And in terms of that address, I think in this we were presented with a world that, where there is actually no longer silence on the other side of the roar, and where an artist is intimately interwoven with every aspect of the world in all countries. And painting this picture, I felt that we were then led towards this crucial question, in which case, how can we actually disengage? And from this point on, I felt as though the question became less about what literature should do, but how do you write a political novel? How is it possible to be true to that double duty to the literature itself and to be true to the situation? In terms of in Egypt, and this was a note that we heard, I felt, all the way through the conversation we've had, that when the crisis is very close, that is actually perhaps impossible. And that the duty there is to be true to the crisis in forms perhaps other than fiction. And what I took away from that is that if a novel should engage in a political way, it should do through paying attention, and possibly quite often after the event, rather than through any sort of intention on the behalf of the author. Following the opening address, we had some fencing around the definitions of what exactly is politics. Where does politics stop? To what extent is Mills and Boone a political novel? And it was decided that quite possibly it was, if politics is on that level of relationships. A quotation was brought into play around the idea that the writer who tried to ignore the contemporary problems in Africa would become irrelevant. From this point on, I'll call this the house on fire metaphor. And it was quite suitably, it was this a metaphor that I felt sort of was able to light the next portion of the debate. When that question was thrown over to Camila Shamsi, it was interesting. We came back to this point of proximity and distance. She said that her own book had begun being written in the contemporary situation, but actually she found herself taking it back into the 19th century, I think, as a way, again, of finding that distance, as a way of perhaps finding that way to actually disengage from the issues that were being faced. At this point, we had a couple of points, one local and one on a global level, the local one being that we needed to have a good close look at what's happening here in Britain, where we are facing the closure of local libraries. And in the light of that, the suggestion was put forward that perhaps it is the duty of the writer to always cut against the grain of government. The global comment, which came from Alan Bissett, was again around the concept of the house on fire, that we can no longer only be concerned with our own houses. And again, out of that, we heard from Ben again this ongoing concern that actually what should come first is the quality of the literature, and that if literature becomes a political tract, then it's effectively, I suppose, kind of diffusing itself. Around these questions also of, I guess, proximity and distance was a question of obligation, this idea of self-censorship, that if the crisis is on your doorstep, do you feel obligated that you have to write about it? This is an idea that we've just heard again from Nick, and to a certain extent from John. So that concept of self-censorship. And I suppose there were a few comments that made me think of something that Seamus Heaney once said, that when he writes about perhaps his first most significant poem, Digging, he felt that it didn't only show him that he had found a way of saying what he wanted to say, but that he'd also found something that he wanted to say. The art had led him to a position on the world. And I mention that because that seemed to be a very common thread through the rest of the conversation, this concept that perhaps the novel is best suited not only being to be written after the crisis, but as a form through which to actually lead us as writers to answer those questions, to find out what we want to say. A point here was made that was very close to my heart coming from Wales, the concept that actually writing in a language can be a statement in itself. It was made in terms of Scots Gaelic. A situation was outlined that I'm certainly very familiar with in Wales, where through the 40s, 50s, 60s, and to a certain extent still now, just writing in Welsh is a statement in itself. Then we went to Denmark. We were asked, where is the fault line? And I thought the next question that really drove the next part of the debate, the question of the market as a totalitarian authority. This was responded to from China, as in the person, not the country, who responded with the concept that actually perhaps the commodification of the novel could be a political tool. He cited the example of Ian Banks. He also threw a question back about to what extent in countries like Egypt has there been a change of form? Have we seen a new avant-garde? And we heard that, yes, actually, the use of both graffiti and poetry in the front line were perhaps somehow better suited than fiction to this role of immediate social engagement. At which point, Ewan Morrison stood up and paced around and introduced the concept of repressive tolerance and asked us to have a look at our failures. Where has literature actually failed? But also to have a look at the success of allegory, citing, of course, probably the most famous allegory, George Orwell's 1984. At which point we had our first question from the audience about what is the role of the reader with the novel as an interpretive form? And the answer came back that, I guess partly it's up to the individual, a point that we certainly heard there voiced at the close, but also that ephemeral art can also matter and can also have an important place, and that we shouldn't be asking about how long will our work survive, how long will it be read, but the concept of art and literature having that impact at the moment. We were presented with a concept that crime fiction was a luxury of peace. This was questioned with a rather wonderful analysis of Argentinian crime fiction. And then towards the close of the debate, I felt we had a sudden switch. We had a series of questions, I felt, really, about the process. Have we made an assumption that literature should always be a correct form, that it is there for us to express our moral values? The question came from Germany. Is the whole issue somewhat old-fashioned? Have other forms, have social networking actually taken over? So again, it was a switch in the direction of the conversation, but I felt also a return to some of the earlier questions as well about is the novel, is fiction the right form that we should be talking about in terms of this kind of a social engagement? John Burnside declared himself an advocate of Emerson, believing that all states are essentially corrupt, and asked, is it the duty of literature to always resist? And then Juno Diaz finished us off by asking, shouldn't we question this whole process? To what extent can we here in this tent, to what extent can we even have this question? To what extent can we have this conversation? Based on the fact that we have all only read a tiny, tiny percentage of the world's literature. But I'll just finish off by saying, I guess that my concerns about the nature of this speech, I should have realized that there would be many questions that would open up from the central question of the conversation. And for me, the chief one, I am pleased to say, has been quite simply about why we do this. Why do we choose to put pen to paper? Why do we either intentionally or accidentally make these statements? And I very much hope that central question of why will be a question that will continue to influence the rest of the conversations that we'll be having here over the next 5 days. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Just as a last note, I want to remind you that the discussion is going to continue. We've asked so many questions, more than the answers we were able to find. But please do check the website, edinburghworldwriterskonferenc.org. This will continue for a year until September 2013. And the debate that we have started here is going to move on to different countries around the world, different cities around the world, like Istanbul, like Cape Town and Toronto. So please do also contribute to the online discussion, and we shall all together turn this into a global discussion together. Thank you. Thank you.
Can I just say thank you to a fantastic contribution from AHDAF SOUEIF. Thank you to Elif Shafak, and both of them will be signing copies of their book around the corner in the signing tent. Come back tomorrow to hear the wonderful Ali Smith talk about style versus content. Thank you.